Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, dear colleagues, dear guests, it's a very special privilege for me today to open this webinar, Man, Microbes, Music and Food. We originally planned this webinar to be a live face-to-face event, but due to the circumstances, the live event has been transferred into next autumn. But we will use this as a teaser and as an introduction to what is coming later. And it's a really, truly multidisciplinary and multicultural effort made possible by the European Union Erasmus program and a generous grant from the CONE Foundation. By this short introduction, let's start our journey to man, microbes, music, and food. And the first part is presented by an Argentinian expert from A16 winery, Mauricio Boullade. So please.
My name is Mauricio Boullade. I'm the CEO of A16 Winery. A16 Winery is located in Luján de Cuyo, Mendoza, and was founded in 2007 by Gerardo Cartelone. Gerardo Cartelone is not only an entrepreneur and loves wines, he also loves arts. Because of that, we have in our winery a lot of sculpture, paints, and of course, music. Producing wine, we take care of all details. We make harvesting by cases, we select bunches, we select berries, and then take care of every little aspect of the production, and we take care to look forward to have the best wine in South America. When we use music in our process is because one of the most important part of the process is the aging, and we make aging in the wines in concrete vats, egg-shaped concrete vats, stainless steel tanks, and also in oak barrels. In all of the winery, we have music 24/7, and why we believe the music influence in the aging and to obtain better wines. Our founder read about Masaru Emoto, that was a Japanese businessman that studied the influence of the music and the sounds in the water. According to him, he studied that the music could be influenced the water, and he make ice, and the shape of the ice has better shape when they are influenced by music or good vibes. This influence in the water, we believe that make us to obtain better wines. This is not a scientific study for us, it's what we believe, and because of that we make it. And also music influencing people, because also we are 60% of water in our bodies, so people that are in a better environment, working in a more happy, of course the result will be much better. Also, we age the wine in egg-shaped concrete vat because we believe that cosmic energy make that the all the leads and all the must move itself inside the egg, and also that energy influence in obtain better wines. Our wines are a single vineyard in our own vineyard there in Luján de Cuyo, and our products are exporting now to all continents, especially to Asia, United States, Canada, and Europe. Also, we say that we don't sell wine, we sell a piece of our terroir, and we invite people around the world to taste this wine. And of course, the best wine is the one you taste in a good occasion, with friends, with family, and if you listen music also during the tasting or enjoying your meal, of course, that will be a much better experience. Our next step is to experience the music with our vines, our plants. The common belief for us is like when you have a good relationship with your plants, they grow much better. So we are thinking in the way to put music to our vineyards and then looking for obtain better grapes.
Okay, a great presentation. There is a question, how are the pieces of music that are played chosen?
Hi to everyone. We play classical music in our winery because we believe that it's not only the music, it's only how the music sounds. And in this case, classical music is a very, in general, the sounds are more well connected. In the case we play heavy metal, we believe that sounds could make a different, obtain different type of wines.
Since there are no more questions, at least for the time being, so onwards to next.
I have a question, if you allow. Mauricio, when do you start playing music? From the very first fermentation, or just during the time you keep the wines in the barrels?
No, from the beginning, from the very beginning. Process. Because indeed we have also speakers in the outside of the winery, so from the grape arrive to the winery, they start the music. But we believe the more influence is during the aging time, because you have the wine maybe in a barrel a couple of years. So it's a couple of years that wine is influenced by the music.
Thank you.
Okay, it is time for the next presentation.
Wine and music, timeless companions, ancient and modern biotechnology. Neolithic humans harnessed the metabolic capabilities of microbes without knowing microbes at all, while they were trying to improve the digestibility, palatability, and shelf life of their newly abundant food. Although musical instruments and musical activities are more ancient by far than wine, since the invention of wine, they have been time-long companions. The earliest evidence for grape wine and viniculture comes from Georgia in the South Caucasus regions, dated around 6,000 years before Christ. But why is this discovery so important? Because it is the earliest biomolecular archaeological evidence for grape wine and viticulture as we know it in the West. Because it is crucial to the later history of wine in Europe and the rest of the world. The Near Eastern uplands were the world center of the Eurasian grape, where the wild plant achieved its greatest genetic diversity. Today, there are some 8,000 to 10,000 domesticated cultivars of wine, raisin, and table grapes. many cultivars in Georgia have a close relationship with those in the West, including Pinot Noir, Nebbiolo, and Syrah. Iconographic evidence shows the link between wine and music used in religious and spiritual ceremonies and banquets, even mortuary banquets. From Hathor and Osiris in Egypt until Dionysius or Bacchus for Greeks and Romans, several gods were associated with wine. Both wine and music played an important cultural role in forming and strengthening social bonds as a complement to the sacred and the path to the afterlife, and even as a source of power. Speaking of power, among the wonderful things discovered into the tomb of Tutankhamun, there were several sistrums and two trumpets, one silver and one bronze. In 1939, the BBC recorded their sounds. Interestingly, 26 wine jars were also discovered. Each bore an inscription describing the sweet wine it used to contain. Like a modern label, these inscriptions recorded the wine, the source, the vintage, and in some cases, even the vintner. The world's first wine labels. Wine consists of around 86% water, 13% alcohol, mainly ethanol, and 1% secondary metabolites. This complex mixture of chemical compounds define a wine's appearance, aroma, flavor, and mouthfeel properties. These sensorially active chemical compounds originate from the grapes, microbes, which come from the soil of the vineyard and from the winery. Grapes and grape musts naturally contain a mixture of microbes. During fermentation, there is a sequential development of some yeast and bacteria. Once anaerobic conditions are established in the vat, nutrients become depleted and the concentration of ethanol increases. Such conditions favor Saccharomyces cerevisiae, with the most efficient fermentative metabolism that are able to withstand low pH, high sulfite, and high ethanol environments. A widely used practice is to inoculate grape musts with fast fermenting strains to ensure rapid and reliable fermentations. However, by doing that, the desirable yeast originating from the grapes have limited opportunity to contribute to the complexity of the wine. Thus, to preserve the regional characteristics of their wine, some winemakers prefer to conduct spontaneous fermentations comprising mixing and sequential dominance of indigenous non-Saccharomyces and Saccharomyces yeasts. A wine yeast converts grape nutrients into ethanol, carbon dioxide, and secondary metabolites through its glycolytic metabolism, which impart aromas that can enhance or diminish the quality of wine. Some grape derived compounds such as acid, including L-malic acid and polyphenols, remain largely untouched by the yeast, while the other compounds are wholly generated. A secondary process that can improve the quality of many red wines and some white and sparkling ones is malolactic fermentation, carried out by lactic acid bacteria during or after alcoholic fermentation. Malolactic fermentation is in fact a decarboxylation process in which L-malic acid from grapes is converted into L-lactic acid and carbon dioxide, resulting in deacidification, flavor modifications, and microbial stability of wine. Oenococcus oeni and Lactiplantibacillus plantarum are the main responsible for this process, since are the best adapted species to the harsh conditions of wine. The biosynthesis of aroma compounds during malolactic fermentation includes the activity of enzymes present in lactic acid bacteria, such as glycosidases, esterases, phenolic acid decarboxylases, and citratolyases. Malolactic fermentation improves wine flavor by reducing herbaceous notes due to 6 carbon alcohol contents and enhance the fruity aroma, increasing ester contents. Although malolactic fermentation often occurs spontaneously by action of native lab from grapes and cellar, It implies risks such as consumption of residual sugars and formation of undesirably biogenic amines. The use of indigenous starter cultures best adapted to a specific wine producing area is recommended to maintain the wine regional characteristics. In the wine industry, the growing demand for distinctive regional flavors has led to the concept of terroir, defined as the set of physical and biological characteristics, as well as local viticulture and winemaking techniques, which together determine the sensory attributes of the wine. There is evidence that microbial activity is associated with wine terroir. Nowadays, we know that the bacterial and fungal communities of wines are shaped by the grape variety, by geographical and climatic factors, and by winery sources. Thanks to next-generation sequencing techniques that have been used to monitoring seasonal changes in the microbial present in the vineyard. These techniques also allow to prove that the consortium of fungi and bacteria involved in the wine fermentations correlate with the chemical composition of finished wines. Wine and music have parallels and similarities that make them natural partners in creating aesthetic experiences. Winemaking is a collaboration between nature and culture that requires sensitivity and creativity. The wine produced expresses the character of the region, the vineyard and vintage, and the history and culture of the people who make it.
Thank you very much, Lucrecia. There are some questions. How are genetically modified organisms, as in yeasts or bacteria, used to enhance fermentations, or are they used at all at the moment?
Yes, at the moment, there are several transgenic yeasts, but only two of them has reached the market. One yeast capable of made malolactic fermentation using one yeast of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, able to do the malolactic fermentation using genes from Schizosaccharomyces pombe and from bacteria. Despite the potential benefit, there is an ongoing anti-GMO campaign, so it does prevent the widespread uptake of the genetic modified wine yeast in commercial wine productions.
Okay, thank you. And to all attendees who have joined us a bit later, welcome to all of you. And everyone, please do not hesitate to ask questions in the chat. And let's move on to the next presentation.
Tengo la sensación de estar tomando un vino muy caro, con mucho cuerpo, que se expande. Me parece un rutini. A ver, voy a probar de vuelta. Confirmo, le da mucho más cuerpo al vino que sin la intervención del piano. Sí, incluso siento una consonancia entre los graves del sonido y el peso del vino, como sentí que el vino también tenía notas graves. Como me parece que hay como mucha madera interesante y también sentí una consonancia entre como los pizzicatos con cierta acidez de la fruta. Creo que eso es todo.
Okay, there are a couple of questions. The music can change sensory properties of wine. Can the wine change how the music sounds apart from intoxication?
Hi, could you listen to me?
Yes.
I just wanted to make a point. There was a slight delay of the video. The point of the glasses is to synchronize the music with the exact moment when you drink. So in the video you couldn't see because there is a slight delay, but it's in the precise moment. With respect to the question, I don't know of any studies of the effect of wine on music perception, but I suppose that there will be, there have been some studies on the effect of smell, for instance, in the perception of visual art, of paintings. So for instance, a nice smell, a pleasant smell could enhance the appreciation of a painting or its pleasantness or perception of the artistic quality. So I suppose that the effects go both ways.
Thank you. There is another question that Synesthesia is a multisensory experience where you get two sensory inputs at once, for example, sound and color. Would it be possible to simulate synesthesia or modify multisensory experiences with augmented glasses?
Yes, well, synesthesia is a particular phenomenon. It's not exactly what we are exploiting in the glasses. In the glasses, we use something that we all have, that is, that we associate a taste with a sound. But synesthesia is a special phenomenon that just a reduced percentage of the population has. Of course, you can simulate it. For instance, sound and color. Scriabin was a composer, a Russian composer, that associated each note, a C with red, a D with yellow, and so on. And so you can design, for instance, a keyboard that also is a luminous keyboard with colors. So you synchronize the color that Scriabin had with the sound, but it's not really, you can, more interestingly, it seems that you can train synesthesia either by pharmacological methods, for instance, taking drugs, psychedelic drugs. You can listen to music and see colors, and or by training, just presenting someone colors and sounds many times, and they learn to and they have similar reactions as synesthetes, and also by hypnosis, by post-hypnotical suggestion. So there are some methods to do that.
Thank you, Bruno. There was another presentation from you, so let's move onwards.
Hi, everyone. My name is Bruno Mesz. I'm from National University of 13 de Febrero in Argentina, and I'll be talking about some studies on the effects of sound on bacteria. There exists nowadays a large and growing body of evidence on how sound and music affect organisms, especially plants, and one can quite often see notes about this topic in the news. Much less is known, however, about the effect of sound on microorganisms, despite its ubiquitous presence around them. When we consider sound as a mechanobiological stimulus for bacteria, it is essentially as vibration, since bacteria don't have ears. When an object is disturbed by a mechanical stimulus and starts shaking and vibrating, sound energy is produced. This energy is propagated in the form of pressure waves in all directions from the sound source, usually as a longitudinal wave consisting of compression and rarefaction of matter. Here we can see the propagation of a spherical sound wave. The variations of pressure as a function of time at a given point can be represented by graphs such as this one obtained from a recording of a clarinet tone. Generic properties of sound waves that we are going to be talking about are the following. Frequency, the number of oscillations per second measured in hertz. The frequency range of human audition is approximately from 20 to 20,000 hertz. A low frequency in this range is perceived as low pitch, high frequency as high pitch. Sound pressure level. This physical quantity is related to perceived loudness in humans and usually measured in decibels. For instance, 20 decibels would be typical sound level of a library, and 80 decibels of a nearby strain. Most studies with bacteria use the range of 70 decibels, something like a vacuum cleaner from a couple of meters of distance, and 110 decibels, a rock concert at maximum volume. Waveform is related to timbre. Here we see a sine, a square, a triangle, and a sawtooth wave at the same frequency. All these waveforms have been used in studies with bacteria. Let's listen to them. Two different waveforms with the same fundamental frequency have different energy spectrum. This means that we are stimulating bacteria at many frequencies at once and with different intensities for different frequencies, according to the waveform type. Rhythm implies change of waveform over time and intermittency, that is, silences. In studies with bacteria, AM pulses and music have been used. Let's listen to a AM pulse. So far, a few studies on sound or music stimulation in bacteria using speaker-based systems have been conducted. These studies have used a range of frequencies, sound pressures, and duration of treatment. Different experimental setups were used, which makes it difficult to compare results of different studies. For instance, the distances of speakers to bacteria varied, ranging from about 0 to 200 centimeters. It is sometimes unclear how the sonic environment was controlled or how the sound pressure level was measured. Some reported effects of sound and music on bacteria were the following. Bacteria showed an effect of sound across a wide range of frequencies. Cell colony forming and growth rate increased using 100 to 10,000 Hz. Music was able to significantly affect microbial growth and production of certain key metabolites. Sound pressure level had a significant effect on biomass viability, doubling the duration of the exponential phase. Sound intermittence, that is, having periods of silence, increased the yield of recombinant protein. Combined effects of frequency and AM pulse rate on yield of recombinant protein were observed. We may conclude that there appear to be promising effects of using audible sound and music on microorganisms. The causes of the effect of music on bacteria are not well understood. The correlations of basic sound features with the effects observed are complex, and there is need to better control of experimental setups, that is, of sonic environments, sound stimuli, and measurement methods. Thanks for listening.
Thank you again, Bruno. There is a question. What kind of music did you play for the bacteria?
Well, I haven't done any studies, but of course, Sami in Finland has done a couple of them, so he will talk about that later. But other people, mostly is curious because many studies were made in India, so a lot of classical Indian and Hindustani music was played. And in other studies, classical music like Mozart, Beethoven, even contemporary music like Georgi Ligeti, Latin and African popular music, this is not for bacteria, but for human cancer cells. There was a study using Quran recitations because, well, it was a study in Iran, so they use that sound. So a wide variety, and Finnish music, of course.
Another question, do you know what is the mechanism behind the increased recombinant protein yield with the music intermittence pauses in music?
No, really, we don't have a clear idea. I think Gabriel will talk a little bit. Bacteria have a way of sensing vibrations, even very small vibrations. So there may be a potential mechanism, but really we don't know yet.
Okay, it seems no further questions. So let's move on to Gabriel's presentation.
Hi, my name is Gabriel Vinderola. I'm researcher and professor at the National University of Litoral here in Santa Fe, Argentina. And we will be discussing some results, some recent results that are under revision that we got with colleagues from Finland. As I mentioned, this result has been just sent, so we can talk about them very briefly. This was performed with colleague from the University of Turku, the Senayoki University of Applied Science, and the University of Helsinki. What inspired us? In March 2019, a news came that was very surprised that researchers from the Bern University of Art, they ripened Emmental cheese in the presence of different music, and they got different flavors, different sensorial properties. So, if we go and take a look about the effect of sounds on different organisms, you can find some very funny titles like this. For example, testing the AC/DC hypothesis: rock and roll and rock is noise, pollution, and weakens atrophic cascade. And if you go down in the species, for example, you can find studies carried out in piglets, in fishes, and even if you go under in the scale. You can ask yourself, what about microbes? If microbes, they can sense music, and if they can respond to them. And here you know that cyanobacteria, they are bacteria that contaminate water and give the water those blue or green colors. So in this study, they try to use music to fight cyanobacteria. So we try to set a small pilot experiment. This experiment consisted in utilizing cabins that are isolated, and you can control temperature. And there we store Gouda cheese, freshly produced, not ripened yet, for 4 months during 12 degrees. And three pieces of music were composed with different tempo, frequency, and we wanted to analyze what was the impact on the microbiological counts and the sensorial properties. We can just anticipate that we got a significant 0.5 log cell reduction in both MRS and M16 agar. These are agar plates we used to count lactobacillus and coccus. And we observed that for music too. And cheeses exposed to that music also were perceived as different. What we think it may happen, this is a hypothesis we have to test. You know that this phenomenon in bacteria, bacteriolysis or disruption, where the membrane integrity is broken and the cell can release the cytoplasmatic content. This content can be protease, peptidase, that they can act on cheese proteins and then change the flavor and the taste, and that may impact the sensorial properties. No, in brief, a reduction in the cell counts can be due to the cell lysis, and the cell lysis can be the reason for the change in sensorial properties. What will we doing in the future? Well, we need further experiments to confirm the finding. We need to use bigger sample size, more repetitions, and maybe testing along the ripening, not only at the end. We are thinking in making it only also metagenomics or 16S rDNA sequencing. So we will know the overall composition and proportion of all bacteria, not the only ones that you can count on agar media. And if we can, we will do mass spectrometry to analyze all metabolites produced during ripening to try to see if difference can be measured between control cheeses and cheeses exposed to music. Thanks, Kitos. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Gabriel. So let's carry over the question to Bruno. Do you have any idea about what's the impact of silence music intermittence in recombinant protein yield?
No, not yet. We only see some differences, and that's why we need to go further in detail to see if there are metabolites, if there are a different proportion of bacteria. We just saw an effect and in the cheese where the microbiology counts were reduced, where the same cheese where taste was different. So maybe there is a connection, and I can imagine that if cell counts were reduced, maybe that was due to cell lysis. Cell lost viability, release their protease, and the protease may have changed the overall sensorial properties. That is an hypothesis that we need to use other techniques like sequencing, like metabolomics. Well, we are in that way.
Thank you. Another question. With this information, could the timing of music be used to control flavor development?
This is a good question. We still don't know what will be the practical application, but let's imagine that you have an industry producing cheeses, and those cheeses are close to our engine that produces some kind of noise. So maybe that noise may affect, may induce flavors that are not desired. So the practical application may be you can use music to get a better cheese, but also that can make you aware, can make you think about the noise in the company, because that can may ruin your product. So you can go in two directions.
And one more question. Have you tested the combination of cheeses and music with the cheeses that were played music to?
I didn't get it. If we taste.
Is there a difference in taste if you listen to music at the same time when you eat the cheese?
No. Yeah. No, we didn't do that. We didn't do that. It's something of interest that we can add to next step. We plan also to make to try this in shorter fermentation, like yogurt fermentation that takes only 6 to 8 hours. Maybe because here we have to wait for 4 months. So maybe if you can see some effect in shorter fermentations, or maybe sauerkraut that takes 10 days. So there is a variety of food that when we can ferment in the exposed to music.
Yes, one more question. So it is not possible to ruin cheese with music, is it?
Well, we don't know, because bacteria they don't react to music, they react to the components. So for bacteria, maybe they can affect negatively. We have the perception that music is fine for us, okay for us, but bacteria, they don't have that feeling. They are just cells that may be broken down even by music that for us are pleasant. It's an hypothesis, we don't know. We don't expect that music will ruin the cheese.
Okay, thank you, Gabriel. Then it is time for the next presentation.
Hello, I'm Sami Silén, a sound designer and a musician, and also currently a PhD student at the University of Turku here in Finland. My presentation here is a little out of the ordinary, and it provides a new way to represent the fermentation process. You will hear a sound work that is an artistic view of the wonderful world of microbes. And here's a little background. In our team here at Functional Foods Forum Department of Turku University, we have studied how sound and music could affect microbes and their biological properties in fermentation process. In these sound exposure experiments, we have played different music samples and various single frequency sound waves and different kind of noises to the maturing cheese. And all this happened throughout the whole ripening period of the cheese, which in this case was 4 months, day and night. Well, it's not time to review the results of the experiments here, but it will certainly happen in the near future. In the meantime, we can think about what kind of possibilities sound exposure could have, especially in fermentation. Maybe we could further the microbiological changes needed for the process, or maybe we could find a sound-assisted recipe to make perfect cheese, kombucha, or maybe sauerkraut. But I have to say that we certainly don't exactly know what kind of music microbes like, but we keep on searching. Another theme of my sound work here is how do environmental noise affect microbes? We do not yet know how, for example, noise or various man-made sounds affect on well-being and favorable development of microbes. Do we unknowingly do harm to these little fellows who are essential to human life? We should take care of them and make sure we do nothing irreversible, at least in the form of sound pollution. During these sound exposure experiments on the cheese, we obsessed microbes by playing the music we have chosen for our own purposes. But what would happen if we reversed this setup? What if the microbes could play music for us? This sound work we are about to hear is based on the sounds of various fermentation processes. We hear some of the sounds as they appear in the real life, but we also hear some sounds that are actually very heavily manipulated by sound programs and tools on a computer. The way these sounds are composed together, I have used my own sonification formula that I created years ago. This method allows that the growth of the microbial population can be presented with notes and rhythms. My formula is not mathematical, but it's purely artistic. The picture you see here in the background is the basis of this composition. Well, this is the sound of fermentation, how I experience it, and the work is called Disturbed Microbial Universe. Thank you.
Thank you, Sami. A very interesting concert. Two questions. Have you had different bacterial species compose music? If yes, do different species make different music?
Oh, this far I have only experience with cheese and all the ingredients that that are there. They are basically behind this my point of view. But in the near future, we are certainly doing some other setups with other. So I'll probably know a little more how they react to music later on.
And another question, could the music the bacteria make be used to predict their properties, sort of reverse engineer from the sun to bacteria?
Yeah, I think so. And I know there are a few studies that has already been done that way. I'm really don't know those that exactly, but it's kind of a way how to express or study a big amount of a different. As a bacteria or microbes, they are huge in a population wise and count wise. So there have been a couple of studies that use sonification as a method to hold that information together, but it's taking baby steps at the moment.
And then one more, an interesting point of view. What about copyrights if the cheese is doing the composing?
Well, I have to think about that. At this point and this time, this is a very interesting way presenting music. Bacteria play music for us, and we play music to bacteria. But for sure, I'm really sure that we have the greatest and the most largest audience among bacteria and ourselves these days. Millions of listeners or species that react to me.
Indeed. All right. Time to move onwards to the next presentation.
Hi, I'm Jean-Christophe Sakdavong from the CLLE Laboratory and the University of Toulouse in France. Today, I will tell you a few words about the effect of virtual reality environment on food and drink perception. Usually, we are eating and drinking either in restaurants or at home. These places are our natural environment for these activities. Unfortunately, scientists are needing sensory boosts in order to control the environment while analyzing food and drink perceptions. Why do I tell unfortunately? It's because we know that the environment is completely changing the perceptions of food, drinks, the liking, and also the taste. So many studies have proven that sensory boosts are not a very good place for food and drink enjoyment. As a consequence, researchers have searched solutions in order to avoid this problem. With virtual reality, researchers have a kind of solution. I will present you now a few papers showing how we can use virtual reality in order to bring more ecological environments for food and drink perception analysis. I will also tease a bit what we will propose you in the next webinar. A sensory booth is a very neutral environment. This kind of environment are not able to activate the memory that we have of dinners in restaurants or at home, for example, and link this to the embodied cognition or grounded cognition theory from Barsalou. But if we immerse participants into a virtual reality environment, it may help to activate this grounded memory of the places and then bring us a better environment for analysis of food and drink perceptions. The feeling of presence, as described by Lee in 2004, is a subjective feeling which can be very interesting for or purpose. According to Lee, this feeling of presence has three main factors: the physical presence, which is more about the environment, the social, about the other persons around us, and the self, about the feeling of that it's really our own body, which is in the environment. So I think it's really interesting to see how this can help to make a better environment for food and drink perception analysis and enjoyment. We will now see three studies which have tried to do this. The first two experiments were conducted at the Cornell University. The first one was experimented about eating blue cheese in three different VR environments. The first environment was a traditional sensory booth, but in virtual reality. The other was a bench in the Cornell Botanic Garden, which was kind of neutral. And then the third one was a feeding in the Cornell dairy barn with several cows, and so had a kind of a smell idea behind it. They used 360 degrees video with Oculus VR headset. And the data they were collecting was the liking, the saltiness, and the pungency. Also, immersion was checked. The main result they got is that when you were in VR in the farm, the pungency of the cheese was much more felt. So this shows that virtual reality environment has an effect, a significant effect. The second study was about drinking sparkling wine and a very good beer. They had two environments. First one was VR, typical college bar with rock music, but not too loud music. And the second one was a tasting room in an expensive local winery with classical music at the same level as the rock music. They were measuring liking, sweetness, bitterness, and controlling immersion, asking about the appropriateness of a beverage according to the VR context, the willingness to pay for the drink. And the only main result that they got is that the willingness to pay and the overall enjoyment of the sparkling wine increased in the winery, but nothing happened for the beer. Then the third experiment was about chocolate, milk, white, and dark chocolate. They had three environments. The first one was a traditional sensory booth. I mean, it was not in VR. And then they had two VR environments, a positive one, which was a sightseeing tour in a five-star hotel, as you can see here, and it was so positive. And there was a noisy live music concert on a cloudy day, crowded with people, as you can see here. They were using the same technology, about 360 degrees videos, and they were measuring the liking, the sweetness, the bitterness, the willing to purchase, and also emotions. Their main results between all the hypotheses they had was that changing the context did not significantly affect the hedonic rating of chocolates. But the combination of a dark chocolate and the virtual life concert were really increasing hedonic response and emotions. So this is quite interesting for us. With these three papers, we have seen that virtual reality can be a very interesting environment. But we were always with known environment. What would be the effect? Would be the effect of an unknown environment, for example, being immersed in a microscopic environment showing microbes, fermentation, or in a more artistic environment. For this, you will have to attend to our next webinar. And what would happen if we changed not the environment, but the appearance of the food in VR, as they are doing in this artistic design of aero blankets? It's nothing about scientific what they do, but it's very interesting. They have real food and they change its appearance in virtual reality. We will also try to do this in the next webinar. See you there. Hi.
Thank you, Jean-Christophe. Some questions. Can this virtual reality environment for fruit and drink enjoyment be useful in the future?
Yes, I think it can be used for example, to enjoy more food with a congruent environment. If you are eating very exotic food from very warm country, eating them in the congruent place would be really, I think it can higher the enjoyment or the hedonic aspect. So it can be very, very interesting. And we are on the way to try if it's working, it's bringing something.
Okay, another question. Could food help with the feeling of immersion into a fictional virtual reality world?
Yes, it is. It could really higher the feeling of presence. For instance, there is not, I don't know any experiment with food, but you have virtual reality headsets who have inside them a mechanism for smell. And so it's giving the smell according to the context in order to enhance this this feeling of presence, this immersion. So it's on the way, and we will also try it with the food and measure if it's really doing what was asked.
A question: have you tried some unconventional combinations, like playing rock in a winery and classical music in a rock club?
No, we haven't. And with Bruno Mesz, who was here, we are on the way to do some experiments a bit with this idea about, for example, winter or summer environment with different kind of it could be with different kind of food, but we are doing it with different kind of music, for example. So maybe it's a bit of idea.
Another question: did you ask if the persons enjoying the chocolate preferred a certain type of chocolate over others?
So it wasn't my experiment, but if I remember well, they were doing it. But it was as I was telling, it was influencing only in a specific context. So I cannot tell more because it wasn't my experiment. Sorry.
All right. And that is about it. We are closing in on the end of our webinar. There are some closing words from Anu.
Yes, a few words before I think we will open the floor then to open discussion also from the audience. I'm Anu Hopia, professor in food development at University of Turku, and one of these members of this wonderful research team, or artist and research team that have presented our work for you and shared our work with you this afternoon or morning, depending on where you are on the globe. First of all, we would like to thank very much Kone Foundation and Erasmus Program for the support that we have got to be able to arrange this mini webinar, and also Finnish dairy company Justoportti provided us the cheese samples for our studies. Just to very briefly tell you about the aims and work that we are doing. We have had now for 2 years activities ongoing to study whether sound could impact the fermenting microbes, those in wine and cheese. And if so, can these impacts be detected either by chemical or microbiological methods, or can they be the changes be perceived via human senses? As you also probably noticed, this is sort of a dive into unknown. We really don't know yet whether or how can sound influence on living organisms like microbes. And we think that this also could be a fruitful interface between science and art. And as you could see from our presentations, we have approaches both from science and from art. We started this webinar with a wonderful presentation from Mauricio Boullade's winery, showing how art and craftsmanship can open new windows also for science. We heard from Mauricio's presentation that actually he had got the idea from some preliminary scientific studies. So we have noticed that this is a wonderful dialogue between art, science, and craftsmanship, and we hope that kind of dialogue continues and develops along the way. Then thank you very much, Lucrecia, for your beautiful presentation on first of all wine and music, their relationships since ancient times, and the opening the possibility that microbes might be part of that play from the ancient times as well. Bruno Mesz and your experiments on interactive wine classes, showing us multisensory perception of wine, role of music there as part of that sort of a overall perception, and using class as an instrument. We really hope that we will get you to visit us to Finland next fall, so that we can continue this experimenting together and could present more of this kind also next fall.
Yes, yes, we cross fingers also.
Yes. On that. Yes, we have.
If the corona allows.
Exactly, yes. Let's hope so. Then I really love your approach on and sort of a courage to approach this kind of a seemingly ridiculous questions, starting to study them through scientific lenses. We are, as you mentioned, and also as Gabriel mentioned, we are in a very beginning of research in this field, and we really need to be patient in building hypotheses, testing hypotheses, collecting experimental data to even start to understand this phenomenon more deeply.
Yes, and if I may thank also, we have a sound team here in Argentina with Gustavo Basso and Andrea Farina that are essential for the acoustic part of the next experiment.
Yes.
So thanks to them. I think they are here.
Yes, I think we really have to acknowledge their expertise in this field as well. And then thank you, Gabriel, for really starting to build hypotheses about the possible mechanisms that might be behind these observations. But as said, we are in a very beginning.
I think if we are able to make 16S profiling and metabolomics, we will have the answer. Those two tools are very powerful. We will see the difference. We will see if they are, we will see using them.
Yes, yes. And hopefully we will be able to do those studies in the near future. Thank you, Sami, for your art of fermentation. It's really wonderful to have here members who approach this theme both from artistic and from scientific angles, and I think this is one of the exciting elements of this kind of work. And it was nice to hear how actually close to human sounds are the microbial sounds that you generated, whether they were sort of really generated from by microbes or by humans. And I think we have to really solve this issue in the future. Thank you, Antti Ville, for that comment. And then finally, we heard Jean-Christophe's presentation on VR and we hopefully can also learn whether VR could be used as one tool to somehow understand the life of our fellow microbes better. Let's see what happens next fall when we all get together. And as Bruno said, cross fingers, hopefully we will all get together, and we invite all of you to join this either as collaborators. We hope that we will build new partnerships around this topic. And already now, please mark your calendar. Three dates next fall. We will have in beginning of October sort of a kickoff workshop on this topic in Helsinki, Finland at KONE Foundation's Lauttasaari residence. Hopefully face-to-face, at least then virtually if world the situation continues to be unfortunate. Then in October 28th, we will have a workshop and also a multisensory dinner in Finland, in Seinäjoki. There is Kalevan Navetta Art Center, where we will have another event and always present step-by-step themes that and lessons that we have learned along the way. And then end of the year, December the 3rd, we will have in Turku, at University of Turku, a seminar and also a multisensory experience afternoon. This is all I can say at the moment, but we will have an event in Turku in Aistikattila, immersive multisensory space there. And we really hope to have you all there and hope that you enjoyed this hour and a half with us. And and actually I think now we will have another 10 minutes for open discussion. I will close my microphone and hope that somebody else will open his or hers and then share your thoughts and reflections on what you have heard.
There are a couple of questions for the first presenters. If we could go through them. For Lucrecia, there was a question. How have wine labeling practices changed throughout the ages? You are muted, Lucrecia.
Sorry, I'm not an expert, but labels are related to pottery in the very beginning, and how the development, technological development of pottery allowed or facilitated trade of wine. So at the beginning, the labels were inked in the pottery, as we saw in the tomb of Tutankhamun. And then I think in 18th century, the wine was bottled. So the labels were, since then the labels are pretty much modern labels.
Yes, let me add that in some point, yes, the trade of wine was in barrels. So the first labels were in the side of the barrel, a big one, because the wine used to be draft in that moment. And after that came the bottle and then the regular labels.
There is one question for you, Mauricio. Do you know if the shape of the aging vessel, if it's a barrel or if it's egg-shaped, does it impact the flavor?
Yes, of course. As I explained in my video, we are aging in concrete egg pads. Of course, it is a part of it is the shape. The other is the temperature that make a convection movement and the energy. And that makes a process that sometimes we make by hand, like in a barrel, like batonnage, make it itself all the time. So the all the time, there are the all the leads and everything moving inside the egg. And also the eggs provide the micro-oxygenation through the concrete walls. So it's an aging similar to a oak barrel, but not adding any oak flavor. So it's a different way, and the wines are really good.
Thank you for the answer. Seems like no more questions in the chat, at least. How about the presenters? Do you have any questions for each other?
Mauricio, do you think we can think in setting up an experiment, a controlled experiment in the future, if we want to measure some metabolites in the wine, for example, to have the vessels exposed to music, but also a vessel in silence?
Yes, of course.
If we get the funding, for sure.
We are interested in continue learning about this matter. Also, as I explained in the video, we also want to impact in the plants. In the future, we are figuring how to do it. But the idea, of course, is to hopefully go to more scientific explanation what we believe. And of course, as I explained also, that we want to take care of every detail during the process. If you, the scientific, can help us, will be much better for everyone.
Great to know that you are available to make that kind of experiment. That would be very interesting.
And we have to pair the wines with the cheese with music.
Yeah.
And we have to try also heavy metal versus classical music. It's very important to control the environment, the sound of the environment, the technical aspect, the acoustical aspect.
Remember that in the
oak aging, you have barrel from 225 liters, you have barrel 500 liters, you have 1,000, 2,000. So there are different type of bats, and maybe there will be different effects also.
Yes, different frequencies of resonance of the whole body of the barrel with the wine.
I know that both Finnish people and Argentinian people like tango very much. So that could be something to compare as well, because there are some differences between Finnish tango and Argentinian tango.
Yeah.
Perhaps also some differences in the wines produced in Finland and in Argentina.
Possibly.
Yet Finnish tango is very interesting. I had the opportunity to attend a meeting where they dance. It was nice.
Well, likewise from our side, we have been able to attend the Argentinian tango meetings, and it's quite different.
Yeah.
Maybe the vibration of the dance, we can also transmit some vibration of tango dance to bacteria. It's possible.
Okay. No more questions. Everything clear for the future and for the autumn. So perhaps on my behalf, I would like to thank all the presenters for the time and effort you have used for producing this webinar. And it's great to work together with such a multicultural, multisensory, multidisciplinary team. And let's hope that the work will bring some new aspects to science, both in the music side and in the food side. Thank you very much, all.
Thank you also.
Thanks, Seppo.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And thanks to all the attendees who are still here for attending.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.